Vakratunda Mahakaya Surya Koti Samaprabha Nirvikram Kurume Deva Sarvakaryeshu Sarvada Sarasvati Namastubhyam Varade Kamarupini Vidyarambham Karishyami Siddhir Bhavatame Sadam Gurave Sarvalokanam Vishaye Bhavaroginam Nidhaye Sarvavidyanam Dakshinamurtaye Namaha Ishvaro Guru Ratmeti Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyomavat Vyapta Dehaya Dakshinamurtaye Namaha Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam Shruti Smriti Purananam Alayam Karunalayam Namami Bhagavat Padam Shankaram Loka Shankaram Sakshat Krutam Dayanandam Paramartha Swarupinam Tatva Jnana Prashastaram Pranatosmi Parampadam Om Sahana Bhavatu Sahana Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastuma Vidvishavahai Om Shanti 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 In the last class, we have seen the meaning of the Shantipata, Sahana Bhavatu Shantipata. We have seen in detail. Even if you don't remember every detail of the discussion, because we discussed elaborately, at least you know the meaning of the Shantipata. We can take one mantra for the whole class. A particular mantra can be taken for discussion for one class. It can be discussed elaborately. But at the end of the class, it is definitely sure that you will remember at least the meaning of this in the mantra. So that is the benefit of discussing in detail. And when you listen and listen, more and more clarity will happen. And that over a period of time, you gain more and more clarity. Therefore, don't stop with listening only once. Listen and listen again. Punah punaha shramanam kuryat. So we have to do Shravanam again and again. Again and again, we are not going to hear something different. The truth being the same thing is to be heard. But that is what is required. Therefore, at least spend some time daily for listening. Don't wait for the waves to subside and then take bath. It will never happen. In spite of your busy schedule, every day some time should be spent for Shravanam. So when you give some time for Shravanam, then slowly the priority shift will happen. Now moksha may be the last priority. in your list of priorities, in your list of pursuits, which are the priority list, moksha may be the last one. But slowly, when you gain more and more clarity, when purushartha nischaya becomes clearer, when what you want, that becomes clear, then slowly your moksha pursuit will climb up the ladder of your priority list and it will occupy the first position. So when moksha becomes the first priority, then don't be afraid all the other pursuits will get dropped. No, all the other pursuits will automatically subserve the moksha pursuit. That happens. That should happen naturally. Therefore, spend some time. Spend some time with yourself in a day. Sit quietly. Don't allow anybody to intrude your private space, private time. And you can extend that time that you spend with yourself slowly. You can extend. So when you are happy around, when we are happy with nobody around yourself, then you have made it. You don't need any external objects or people to fulfill you. With or without external objects, with, without or people around you, I am all right. I am happy. I am secure. That is the freedom. Since throughout our life, our sense organs and the mind, they are externally directed. Always it flows out. Paranchikani, that shloka is, that mantra will come later. Our sense organs are externally directed. It always goes out. So we don't enjoy the freedom which is already you. You don't enjoy the freedom which is already you. You are the meaning of the freedom. Therefore, to enjoy that, to understand, to know that I am the meaning of the very word moksha, shravanam should be proper. Shravanam should happen. We should spend some time for shravanam of the sambandha bhashyam. Sambandha bhashyam is the bhashyakara connects the Upanishad with an introduction. That is called sambandha bhashyam. The anubandha chatushtayam, if you remember, fourfold connections, what we discussed in Tattvabodha as well as in the introduction to Gita. The anubandha chatushtayam, fourfold connections are different for Veda Purva and Veda Anta. In Veda Purva, moksha is not pradhanam. Dharmartha kama is the pradhanam. Whereas in Vedanta, moksha is the pradhanam. And for Veda Purva, you are motivated by some desires. Desires prompted by dharmartha kama purushartha. Whereas in moksha, the desire is to know yourself. Because that is the meaning of freedom. And therefore, the qualifications required for the people, the person who pursue Veda Purva is different from Vedanta. So the eligibility and the part of the student is also different. And Veda Purva deals with a lot of karma and upasana, whereas Vedanta is about listening and understanding and living an alert life. That is what Vedanta. Therefore, Bhagavad Pada, he has to give a connection to the Upanishad from the Vedanta point of view. This is talks about moksha. Therefore, how the Upanishad deals with moksha, the topic discussed in the moksha, that has to be given in the form of an introduction. That is called Sambandha Bhashyam. Sambandha is connection. So connection to the Vashyam, by giving the fourfold connection, Anubandha Chatushtayam, and also giving the meaning of the very word Upanishad, which is Vedanta, which Acharya gives in the Sambandha Bhashyam. And this Sambandha Bhashyam, every Upanishad, it will have an introduction, Sambandha Bhashyam. It is called Sambandha Bhashyam. It is also called Upodghata, an introduction. In Bhagavad Gita, it's Upodghata, we say. And here it is a Sambandha Bhashyam. Not much difference. So, Bhagavad Pada, he begins his commentary with a Prarthana, the prayer, Om Namo Bhagavate Vaivasvataya. The meaning of this Prarthana, I told, if you remember, the class before, the last or even before that, I told. But still I will explain the meaning. Om Namo Bhagavate Vaivasvataya. The Prarthana starts. The very first letter of the Bhashyam is Om. That is how the Bhashyam starts. Om Namo Bhagavate. Om is, if you remember, Om is, we discussed, Shabda Brahma. Om is Shabda Brahma. Sound symbol of Brahman. Brahman is Mangalam. Bhagavan is Mangalam. Bhagavan Nama is Mangalam. Any name of Bhagavan you take, it is Mangalam. And Om, when you say Om, Om, it covers everything. It covers the whole Jagat. It covers what you know and what you don't know. Both the Jnata Vishayam, Ajnata Vishayam, both are covered. There are only two things in the world. One is that you know. Another one that you don't know. So what you know and what you don't know, that is what the whole Jagat is. The whole Jagat can be covered only by these two. And Om covers everything. So covers everything means it includes you also. So therefore, whatever possible in the Jagat, with your Om, you can cover it. So therefore, any word, any Shabda, any word, if you take, it has its being in Om. Anything in the creation, which is indicated, which is represented by a Shabda, by a word, it has its being in Om. The word and the meaning are inseparable. The word, if you say any word denoting a particular object, the moment you say the word, the meaning associated with the word, that also occurs in your mind. Without your will, it happens. So the word and the meaning, they are so together, they are inseparable. Vak and Artha. Vak is the word. Artha is the meaning. They are inseparably together. That is why we say Vagartha Viva Sampraktav Vagartha Pratipattaye. As the Vak and the Artha, they are Sampraktav, Samyak Praktav. They are well joined together. They are inseparably together. That is how the Jagatav Pitarav also. Jagataha Pitarav, the father and the mother of the world, Parvati Parameshwarav, they are together. So, all the words, if you take, it have its origin, it have its sustenance, it have its resolution in Om. And we know Brahman is that from which everything originates, everything is sustained, everything finally resolves into Brahman. Therefore, Om is nothing but a pratika. It's a symbol for Brahman. As all the words resolve into Om, and as everything resolves into Brahman, Om is nothing but a pratika, a word symbol for Brahman. And therefore, Om is auspicious. Mere chanting of Om, that brings all auspiciousness. Therefore, Bhashyakara, he begins his commentary with Om Mangala Shabda. Omkarashchata Shabdascha Dvaveto Brahmanaspura. Therefore, Om is a Mangala Suchaka Shabda. And when you utter and Om, and contemplate on Om with Shraddha and Bhakti, you touch Bhagavan. You spontaneously touch Brahman through Jnanam. Om is not different from Bhagavan. Therefore, when you utter and meditate on Om in the form of a japa, you cover everything by Ishvara. As Om is everything, when you say Om, you cover everything by Ishvara. Ishavasyam idam jagat. Ishavasyam. Asyam is achadaniyam, covering. Covering the whole jagat by Ishvara. How do you cover? By Jnanam. When you understand everything is Ishvara, there is nothing away from Ishvara, nothing is separate from Ishvara, and Om is the pratika, a symbol of Ishvara. So therefore, when you say Om, you spontaneously touch Ishvara, Bhagavan. Whatever you experience with your senses and mind, the jagat, they are Ishvara. If everything is Ishvara, what is there to regret about anything? There is no regrets in life. There is no guilt. There is no hurt. So all the life experiences, what we gain, whether pleasant or unpleasant, or in the form of a guilt or hurt, it is nothing but Ishvara. Our whole life is nothing but the series of experiences. But the problem is we spend more time on handling guilt and the hurt. I am guilty for having done what I should not have done. And it leads to self-condemnation, self-rejection, self-non-acceptance. That is the problem, which is not correct. Even the mistake what you commit, it has a certain background. So given the background, everybody would have followed exactly the same thing what you have done. Therefore, acknowledge it and try to see that everything is within the order of Ishvara. If you see that way, the guilt will resolve. Similarly, hurt also. By acknowledging the order, which is Ishvara, you are inviting Ishvara into your life. That is what the japa does. Japa is not just pleasing God. By japa, you are in touch with Ishvara. You are allowing Ishvara to enter your life. Yeni Nama being the name of Ishvara, Om is the absolute sound representation of Ishvara. So what you understand by the word, very word Ishvara, you represent that by the word symbol Om. That is why every prayer starts with Om. So it is a Mangala Shabda. That is what Bhagavad-gita does. It starts its commentary with Om. We can discuss more on Om. We'll talk about on Om on another occasion. We'll discuss in detail in Mandukya Upanishad. Here this simple introduction to Om is enough. So Om. Then Bhagavad-gita, he offers his namaskara through this shloka to the teacher. To the teacher and to the taught and to the knowledge which was taught. So, Om Namo Bhagavate. Bhagavate. Bhagavate means unto Bhagavan. Namaha. If you do the sandhi, vicheda, Om Namaha Bhagavate. Namaha is a word. Namaha means salutation. I offer salutation to Bhagavan. Bhagavate. Namaha is a word which is an indeclinable word. Avyayam. which governs Chaturthi Vibhakti, therefore Bhagavate. Bhagavate means unto the Bhagavan, to Bhagavan. The salutation, Namaha. And the word Bhagavan is a very beautiful word, Bhagavan. Bhagavan, the word is derived from the word Bhaga. Bhaga is a word from which we get Bhagavan. Bhagaha asya asti iti Bhagavan. Bhaga, the one who has Bhaga is called Bhagavan. The one who has Bhaga. What is Bhaga? The Bhaga, it's a six-fold quality. A group of six qualities is called Bhaga. What are those six qualities? Aishwaryasya samagrasya dharmasya yashasashriyaha jnana vairagya yoschaiva shannam bhaga itirana. That is samagra. Samagra is total. Total Aishwarya. Aishwarya is prosperity. Aishwarya, vibhuti of Bhagavan. Prosperity, absolute prosperity, total prosperity. And total dharma, total virtue. And total yashas. Yashas is the fame. Fame, total yashas. Shriyaha. Shriyaha is, Shriyaha can be taken as wealth, or Shriyaha can be taken as all the auspiciousness. So total auspiciousness, that is Shriyaha. Jnana Vairagya. Jnana is Jnana. Vairagya is the, means dispassion. Dispassion and freedom. Freedom is Jnana. Freedom means, means of freedom. Means of freedom is called freedom. It means Jnanam. Jnanam is a means for freedom. Therefore, Jnanam here is means of freedom. Jnanam. So these six qualities is called Bhaga. And Bhagavan is one who has those qualities in total measure, in absolute measure. Therefore, Bhagaha Asya Asti, the one who has this six qualities is called Bhaga. Therefore, Bhagavate. And to that Bhagavan, who is addressed as Bhagavan here? Bhagavan is Vaivasvataya. Vaivasvataya. Who is Vaivasvataya? Vaivasvataya means son of Vivasvan. Vaivasvata means Vaivasvata. The word Vaivasvata means the son of Vivasvan. So the Putra, Putra of Vivasvan. Vivasvan, the word you would have heard somewhere. In Bhagavad Gita, 4th chapter. Imam Vivasvate Yogam Proktavanagamavyayam Vivasvan Manave Praha Manurakshvakave Bravit. 4th chapter it comes. This yogam I taught to Vivasvate, Vivasvan. Vivasvan means Surya Devata, sun. So Bhagavan Krishna says, I taught this to Surya Devata. So Vivasvan means Surya Devata. Vaivasvata is Surya Putra, son of Surya Bhagavan. So Vaivasvata, yeah. Karna is also Surya Putra. But his mother was Kunti. That is in Mahabharata. Here, Dharmaraja. Yamadharmaraja is addressed as Vaivasvataya. He is a son of Surya Devata. So, Yamadharmaraja is the Bhagavan here. Yamadharmaraja is the Bhagavan and he is the son of Surya Devata. And Mrityave. Yamadharmaraja has got another name, Mrityu. Mrityu literally means death, but here it is the Lord of Death. You have to take it, take the word, the meaning of the word Mrityu as the Lord of Death. Mrityave, to the Lord of Death. Namaha, my namaskara, my salutations. Then Brahma Vidyacharyaya. Brahma Vidyacharyaya. Brahma Vidya Acharyaya. Brahma Vidyacharyaya. Savarna Dirga Sandhya Sapandiya. So Brahma Vidya. What is Brahma Vidya? Brahmanaha Vidya, Brahma Vidya. Knowledge of Brahman, that is Brahma Vidya. Para Vidya, Akshar Vidya, Bhuma Vidya. You can call by any name, Brahma Vidya. The knowledge for which the subject matter is Brahman, that is Brahma Vidya. And how do you know the Brahman? Only through the Acharya, only through the teacher. Therefore, Brahma Vidya Acharyaya. To the Acharya, the teacher, who teaches Brahma Vidya? Who's teaching it as a subject matter of Brahman? Who's teaching as a subject matter which is Brahman? This Brahma Vidya Acharyaya. And who is this Acharya? That is a definition for the word Acharya itself. Achinoticha Shastrani Achare Stapayatyapi Swayam Achare Yasmat Tamacharyam Pachakshate. This is a general definition for the word Acharya. Achinoticha Shastrani is follows what the Shastra says. He conducts himself in line with the Shastra. Achare Stapayatyapi. He makes his followers, the students also, to be established in Achara. Swayam Acharate Yasma, the one who conducts himself in line with the Shastram, he is called the Acharya, and he makes his disciples also to follow the Achara as recommended by the Shastram, and also by living a life of Achara. He is called Acharya. Therefore, Acharya. And this knowledge can be gained only through Acharya. Can you imagine of gaining this knowledge without the teacher? It is impossible. You cannot stumble upon this knowledge on your own. In any discipline of knowledge you take, except this Atmajnanam, self-knowledge, what you have to do is you have to figure out by following the necessary methods, you can figure out the discipline of knowledge. There are many materials are available on that knowledge. So you can take up anything and you can read, and by trial and error, you can by your reading, you can gain the knowledge. When what is sought after by you is that can be brought under observation, which can be brought under analysis, then the knowledge what you want to gain, that will happen without difficulty. There will not be any problem in gaining that knowledge. So anything which can be objectified, falls within the scope of the means of knowledge, which is already within the scope of the seeker. So therefore, any discipline of knowledge will not be a problem. You can gain it by yourself, because the means of knowledge are within your disposition. But in the case of Atmajnanam, the seeker, the student, has no means of knowledge. He cannot use any methods, any means of knowledge independently. Why? Because here, what is to be discovered is the very subject, which can never become an object of observation, an object of analysis. Because this, what you seek, the sought is not an object which is distinct and different from the seeker. The sought is not remote in space and time. Therefore, any independent effort on the seeker is of no use in gaining the Atmajnana, the self-knowledge. Therefore, you need an external factor. You need an external factor for getting a teacher who can help the student to discover the nature of the very subject, the sought. And when you apply the proper and adequate effort to gain the samshaya ragita jnanam, doubt-free knowledge, that what gives you freedom. That is what liberates you from all the limitations. Therefore, it requires a lot of the grace of Ishvara to take the student to the feet of the Guru. A Guru is nothing but the grace manifest. It's a manifestation of a grace. Bhagavata Kripa. And the function of a Guru is to remove the ignorance. The one who has knowledge only can remove the ignorance. Therefore, the teacher must be knowledgeable. The one who knows is the Guru, the teacher. And to get the teaching, to get blessed, the seeker, he has to discover first that he is ignorant. Then only he becomes the real seeker. Everybody is a born seeker. Everybody in the world is a born seeker. We are always seeking one after the other thing. But how to know that the seeking, the very seeking, is due to self-ignorance, ajnana? How do we know that? The effort for atmajnanam, therefore, it begins with the discovery of the fact that I am ignorant about myself. I cannot know myself with the available means of knowledge at my disposition. That one has to recognize. Even this recognition is possible only when you surrender at the feet of a Guru. And the Guru, he converts that the seeker who was ignorant, who was indiscriminate, he converts him to a committed seeker of knowledge. Then the seeker becomes a fit receptacle. He becomes receptive to the teaching. And also the seeker, he discovers the process. He discovers the teacher and the meaning and the purpose of relationship with the teacher. So that, therefore, the acharya is very important. Without acharya, the student cannot gain this knowledge. The source, the means of knowledge is from the external. Therefore, the student cannot come to arrive at the knowledge with his available means of knowledge. What are the available means? He has got pratyaksha, he can use all his sense organs, he can do anumana, inference, arthaparthi, all the means of knowledge which he can use, but that will not help him to know the very sort. And therefore, acharya is required. Acharya in the form of teaching. Teaching is required. So therefore, acharya is the teacher, the one who teaches. Acharya is, or the guru, is not a silent mystic. He's not a mystic. Nor he is a eloquent speaker. No. So in the world now, everybody is after some mystic. Because you get a mystic experience. Any mystic experience will not make you complete, will not remove the self-ignorance, will not make you to say that I am free, I am secure, aham purnaha. Any mystic experience will not make you to say that. Only when you say that I am what I seek, I am complete, aham purnaha, I am ever secured, I am the very meaning of the word moksha. Only when you discover the fact, then only you are with yourself, you arrive at home. Otherwise, it will be a continuous hunting of mystical experiences. And that is why mystics, they don't have tradition of teaching. Except they give some stray statements, and that statement also cannot be understood, which requires interpretations. And Buddha, he never spoke, but there are so many books written on the teaching of the Buddha. Buddha didn't utter a word. They say so many commentaries on what he has not said. And what mystic says, that is very difficult to understand. And that requires interpretation. And the interpretation is based on what the disciple understands. So, and also the experience of the mystic, it cannot be assimilated by the student in terms of the communicable knowledge. Therefore, Guru means, in our tradition, Guru means the living knowledge, who is only capable of removing ajnana, ignorance. Therefore, Brahma Vidya Acharyaya. Acharya is going to teach the knowledge to the seeker on what he is going to teach, that which is beyond the known, the unknown, but by using communication. Certain by communication is going to teach that which is not totally unknown, which is not totally beyond the known, which is not totally unknown. So communicating that in the form of a teaching, that is what the Acharya does. And therefore, the Acharya, a Guru, is called Mahavakya Upadeshakarta. Mahavakya Upadeshakarta. Mahavakyam is a great equation. The great equation which the Upanishad unfolds in the form of a teaching, and the Guru, he unfolds that by adopting certain prakriya, certain methods. Therefore, the student, the seeker, has to receive this Upadesha. Upadesha is not like mantra Upadesha that you keep chanting for a certain period of time. No. Upadesha here is teaching. Teaching from the Guru to know, to achieve the ultimate fulfillment in life. Therefore, he approaches the Guru and is ended by the grace of Ishvara. The seeker, he reaches a teacher, he reaches the feet of a teacher at the right time by the grace of Ishvara. So therefore, here Yamadharma being the teacher and Nachiketa is a great student who has all the qualities required to gain the knowledge. He approaches the teacher. The teacher, none being Yamadharma Raja, to that teacher, I offer my namaskara, Brahma Vidya Acharyaya Namaha. And not only to the teacher, the student also, Bhagavad Pada offers namaskara. Who's a student? Nachiketas. How can a student also be offered namaskara? Nachiketas, after having learned, after having gained the knowledge of Brahman, he also becomes a guru in the tradition. The traditional link, he also becomes a guru. That is the greatness of teaching. Yamadharma Raja was a guru. He makes his Shishya also a guru. So, Nachiketas also becomes a guru in the tradition. So, to him I offer my namaskara. Nachiketase namaha. That is the greatness of the teaching. They say, what is that? That the philosopher's stone or something. That which touches, touches an object, an iron thing, that gains all the qualities of the philosopher's stone. It is different from a magnet. See, a magnet can magnetize an object, a steel object, by in contact with the magnet. But the steel object cannot become a magnet itself. It cannot become a magnet and convert other steel objects. Whereas a philosopher's stones, it converts that which comes into contact with that also into philosopher's stone. It gains the ability to convert another object into philosopher's stone. Guru is like that. So, Yamadharma Raja was a guru. He also made his disciple Nachiketas also become like him. Therefore, Nachiketas also is offered namaskara. Brahma Vidya Acharyaya Yamadharma Rajaya. And tasya shishyaya. Who is that? Nachiketas. Nachiketase namaha. Nachiketase, for the Sanskrit grammar students, that Nachiketas is a pratipadika. Nachiketas is sakaranta, and when you decline, it becomes Nachiketa is pratama vyakti ekavachana. Nachiketa, Nachiketasau, Nachiketasaha. And chaturthi vyakti is Nachiketas, Nachiketase, chaturthi vyakti. And this Nachiketas is a beautiful word. The word cannot be derived regularly, but as some, by applying a Unadi Sutra, we have the derivation. It is an irregular derivation, which is allowed by grammar, which is not against grammar. The word Nachiketas, if you take, it has three parts. Na, Chi, Keta. Three words are there. Na, Chi, Keta. Na means we know. Na means what? Not. Na. Na means not. Chi. The word Chi also we know. Chi, Dhatu. Fifth Gana Dhatu. The Dhatu means the verbal root which is in the fifth conjugation. Chi, Dhatu. It means to collect. Chinoti. To collect. To gather. Keta. Keta means sankalpa. Sankalpa here is fancy. Some fancy. That is called sankalpa. Fancy means the desire or the before the kama arises, there is sankalpa in you. After sankalpa, only kama arises. The desire for the object arises. So it's sort of a fancy. So when you go for a shopping, you see a lot of things. Though you don't have the intention to go to the shopping to buy that thing, the moment you see, you develop a fancy. You develop an attraction towards it. That is called sankalpa. And that attraction, it slowly, if you ruminate on that, that becomes a desire. Then later you want to buy it. So here the sankalpa is, that is what fancy. So, na chi keta. Na not, chi collect, keta fancy. So, the one who doesn't have sankalpa for any material objects, any bhoga vastu, the one who doesn't have sankalpa for dharmartha kama, the person who is free from all worldly desires, is called Nachiketas. So the fancy is the bija for kama, all the kama. The one who doesn't have that is Nachiketas. So it's a beautiful name. So to the Brahma Vidya Acharya and also to the disciple Nachiketas, I offer my namaskara, my salutations. So this is the meaning of the prarthana. After that, Bhagavad Pada, he writes the Sambandha Bhashya. Some of that we have seen in the previous classes. So that I don't want to get into that again. So we will enter into the first mantra of the text. In the PowerPoint, you see the simple meaning of the Prarthana, what we discussed now. This is the first mantra of the first chapter, the first valli. chapter is called Adhyaya. Valli is a section. So, Pratama Adhyaya and Pratama Valli. So, Pratama Valli, the first section, the first chapter. The first section of the first chapter, the Upanishad, starts with the mantra Om Ushan Ghavai. So I will repeat. I will say, you can repeat after me once. Om Ushan Ghavai Vajashravasaha.
Om Ushan Ghavai Vajashravasaha.
Sarva Veda Sam Dadau.
Sarva Veda Sam Dadau.
तस्यः नचिकेता नाम
तस्यः नचिकेता नाम
पुत्र आस
पुत्र आस
ओके सो दिस इज द फर्स्ट मंत्रा द मंत्रा इंट्रोड्यूसेस द कैरेक्टर्स ऑफ द उपनिषद्स There are mainly two characters, three characters. In fact, the teacher and the student, there are only two characters. But here, Nachiketa's father is also introduced. So the Upanishad, it introduces first the person, the name, Vaja Shravasaha. Vaja Shravasaha. Vajashravasaha is the name of the person who is the father of Nachiketas. Vajashravasa is the son of Vajashrava. Son of Vajashrava is Vajashravasaha. Vajashravasaha can be From that name we can know his father name is Vajashrava. Vajashrava is different. Vajashravasa is different. Vajashravas is it is the Pratipadikam Vajashravas. From that we get Vajashravasaha. And son of Vajashrava is Vajashravas. So Vajashrava is a father. Akaranta. Like Ramashabda. Vajashrava is like Ramashabda Akaranta. His son is Vajashravas Sakaranta. Like Nachiketas. So Vajashravasaha. And this Vajashravas is the person, is a Vaidika person, the one who follows the Veda diligently. Is a Vaidika person. He is famous for Annadhanam. He is famous for doing Annadhanam. How do we know Vajashravas is famous for doing Annadhanam? That can be known from the very name itself. The name itself indicates. The name is itself as though a title given to that person. Vaja means Annam. Vajam. Vaja means annam. Shrava means yashas. Yashas is the one who has gained fame. Yashas. Therefore, Vajashrava. Vajashrava. We are deriving the name of the father. Vajashrava. Vaja is annam. Shrava is fame. The person who has become famous through annadanam. The person who is known for charity, charity in the form of giving food to the poor people, to the needy people. So Vajashrava is more a title than a name, Vajashrava. So that is the name of the father of Vajashravas. So Vajashrava's father, Vajashrava, is known for his charitable disposition. Therefore, he is given the name Vajashrava. Okay, so what about Vajashravas now? Vajashravas, he is a Vaidika person and he performed a yajna. He performed an elaborate yajna, a ritual. The name of the ritual is not mentioned here. The name of the ritual is Vishvajit Yajna. Vishvajit is the name of the yajna. That is a huge yajna which involves many highly qualified priests from all the four Vedas. Priests representing all the four Vedas. They are part of the ritual. And also many Brahmanas are required. Many Brahmanas are required to participate for the ritual. So he performed that huge yajna, Vishvajit yajna. And ha and vai, you can see that. What is ha and vai? Ha and vai that it is a particle. Ha and vai is called in particle. In some, particle is that says that this happened long time ago. That is, you are recalling the event which happened long time ago. So by saying that Upanishad, it says this happened. This is a well-known thing, well-known event which happened long before. Ha, vai. What happened? That is, this Vajashravas, he performed a yajna which happened long before. Okay. And this Vishwajit Yaga, yajna, it's a very big yajna. And the uniqueness of this yajna is, the person who performs the yajna, he should give away everything that he possesses as dakshina to the people. Not merely money, but everything. Everything should be given, distributed. Whether it is land or property or wealth in the form of a cattle, any property which is movable or immovable, gold, silver, anything you name it, all has to be given as dakshina. That is why here mentioned sarva vedasam dadau. Sarva vedasam. All the wealth he gave. Dadau. Dadau is litlakara. He gave. Vajashavas, he gave away all the wealth. Where? In the yajna. In Vishwajit Yajna. As what? As Dakshina. As Dakshina, he gave away all the wealth. That word Dakshina will come in the next mantra. Dakshinasu Niyavanasu will come. So he gave all the wealth as Dakshina in the ritual. Sarva Vedasam. Sarva Vedasam is all the wealth. All Sarva Dakshina. Godanam, Bhudanam, everything he did. Godanam is giving of the cow. Bhudanam is, Bhu is Prithvi, Bhumi. Giving the land, the real estate, everything. So Vajashravas, being a Vaidika, he performed this yajna as per the stipulation, as per the as it be done. And Vajashravas, then this Vajashravas performed this yajna with a desire. See, any yaga, any yajna, any karma you do, it must have some purpose. There is no karma without any purpose, without expecting any palam. Nobody will do any action, any yajna. And this is such a big yajna. So definitely Vajashravas would be doing with an expectation, with some pala. So the palam, so any karma you do, the palam has to be mentioned. Any karma, it is done for the sake of the palam. And the palam, based on the palam, the karma can be called kamya karma or nishkama karma. Kamya karma or sakama karma. If a karma is performed with an intention, with a desire to get something, then it is called sakama karma. Sakama karma or kamya karma. If it is performed without a desire, how can we perform any karma without a desire? Just now I said, if no karma can be performed without desire, without a desire means the desire is moksha. The desire is moksha. But moksha cannot be gained by karma. It means, nishkama karma means, by performing it, you are performing karma not just for gaining material benefits, but for gaining the benefits which will lead you to moksha, not directly. Directly, how can you reach moksha? Only by jnanam. Jnanena eva mokshaha, there should not be any doubt about it. Karmana na mokshaha, not by karma. But the karma helps you in getting a certain mental disposition, a certain conducive ambience, environment, that will take you to moksha. For example, We need sadhana chatushtaya sampatti. If all the qualities are present in the seeker, then the knowledge will give him moksha. The knowledge will make him free. It should make him free. And for, okay, and suppose if the student is not endowed with all the qualifications in total, or is in the process of developing those qualifications, at least he needs a certain conducive environment where he can practice certain qualities. Amanitam, Adambitam, Agimsa, Kshanti, Arjam, all those qualities which is mentioned in the Gita and all the sadhana chatushtaya, he needs certain condition. You cannot practice all these things in an Arabian country. It is not possible. You cannot do any all these things in a place where it is where this such teaching is not there. So all this needs Bhagavan's grace, and it needs grace, and in the form of you do karma, and the karma will make it conducive. Karma will make it conducive for gaining that. Therefore, it is the karma is called Nishkama Karma. So Nishkama Karma means, understand that karma, it is performed without desire. When I say the desire is not for material benefits, but for gaining moksha. But not directly, indirectly. Making myself a prepared person, either directly or indirectly. By giving a certain ambience, by making all my sense organs, my buddhi, my intellect very, you know, receptacle for the teaching. So for that we do certain karma, that is called Nishkama Karma. But here what Vajashravas was doing, is it a Sakama Karma or Nishkama Karma? It is not a Nishkama Karma, it is a Sakama Karma. He is doing a karma with an intention, with a desire to gain something. That is what is referred by the word Ushanna. Ushanna. Ushan means desiring the result, desiring the palam, punya palam, that he will capitalize later, either in this janma or after this janma by going to Swargaloka. He will capitalize the result of the yajna palya. So that is what is referred by the word Ushan. Ushan is what? Kshatranta. Kshatranta, those reading in Sanskrit of Ushan, that like Pachan, Ushan. Okay, Ushan means desiring. Ushan means Kamaya Manaha. Bhagavad Pada gives Ushan Kamaya Manaha. So, desiring the result. You did the ritual and Sarva Vedasam Dadau. He gave away all the wealth. If you are doing a sakama karma, if you are doing a karma with a desire, if you are doing a Vedika ritual with a desire to accomplish something, then the ritual must be perfectly done. The ritual must be done properly as it is recommended by the Shastra. There should not be any deviation. There should not be any defect. If any defects are there, then you will not get the palam. That is why when we do simple puja and all, finally we say, mantra lope, tantra lope, shakti lope, kala lope, shraddha lope, niyama lope. Lopa means that I missed something. Lopa is, I did something wrong, the defect, it's called lopa. If I missed something, if I chanted the mantra wrongly, if I missed the kala, the time of doing puja, if I missed the niyama, the certain rules. So all this, we are asking, Kshama, please forgive. Oh Bhagavan, please forgive that. Forgive for all the omissions, what I did, and please accept my puja. So this is what the generally we say at the end of the puja. So that is okay for the puja, simple puja what we do. But when it comes to Vaidika puja and you're doing an elaborate puja, it should be done as it is stipulated by the Shastra. So all the regulations and rules must be strictly followed. Even the dakshina also. The dakshina also should not be less. The dakshina, what you give in the ritual, should not be less. It should be according to the gradation of the priest. Some priests are highly qualified and for them they deserve more dakshina. And some priests probably they would not have done the enough, you know, Veda Adhyayanam. They deserve accordingly dakshina. But what is to be given should be given. Even the priest who comes and who is to be given, it should be given. You cannot judge a priest by what he chants. A priest representing the Yajurveda is there, you must be given what is to be given. Dakshina is an important anga of the yajna. Generally, we have thinking, oh, he didn't chant properly, why should we give? We can give him less. No. If you want the phalam, if you want the phalam of your yajna, if you want to enjoy the phalam of your yajna totally, then the dakshina must be given. Dakshina you are giving is not for the sake of that person, for the sake of yourself, for the sake of completion of your yajna, you are giving this dakshina to the other person. So dakshina should never be compromised. We should not judge the priest based on how he chants, what he chants. If the priest is a person, a particular Veda, and is a part of the yajna, it must be given what is to be given. He deserves that much. Whether he does or not, it is his problem, but it must be given. So that dakshina is an important part. And if you are not following the procedure of the ritual as prescribed by the Shastram, then we will not get the desired result. Not getting the desired result is one thing, but we may get an undesired result. That is the problem. It could be counterproductive. That's a problem. It may cause some other issue. In Mundaka Upanishad, you would have studied, there is a mantra. Yasya agni votram adarsham apurnamasam agutam avidinahutam. So, tasya lokan hinasti, it comes. When karma was condemned in the second section of the first Mundaka, the teacher points out, if the karma is not performed properly, it gives a negative result. So, for the karma, therefore, all the anga of the karma must be followed. All the procedure of the karma must be followed as prescribed by the Shastra. And here Vajashravas is doing Kamya Karma. And for Kamya Karma, all the rules and regulations, including Dakshina, must be followed. So that is a point we should remember. So what is the procedure here? Sarva Vedasam Dadau. All the things what he has, what he possesses, must be given in the Yajna. Why? Because he is Pushan, he is desiring. Desiring what? Desiring Swargaloka. Because he is doing the Yajna with an intention to achieve a particular desire, therefore he must give away all the wealth. That is what he does also. So, Vajashravasaha, Pushan Vajashravasaha, Sarva Vedasam Dadau. He gave away all his material possessions. One by one is giving. Then, Tasyaha Nachiketa Nama Putra Asa. That Vajashravas was performing the Vishwajit Yajna, was giving away all his wealth as Dakshina in the Yajna. He had a son with the name Nachiketa. Nachiketa Nama Putra. What is Putra? Putra means son. Putra is an interesting word. Put namnaha narakat trayate iti putraha. Put namnaha narakat. That is, the son is one who saves the father from going to naraka. Naraka here is because of the karma, negative karma which is performed wrongly, the father goes to Naraka. The son is one who saves him, from, saves his father from going to the Naraka. So Naraka doesn't mean hell. We don't translate Naraka as hell. Naraka is, it stands for any uncomfortable situation. Therefore, Putra, the son, is defined as that person whose responsibility is to rescue the father from any difficulty. So, and who is the Putra here? Nachiketa. So, Nachiketas is the responsible Putra, son, and he is the son of Vajashtavas, is also watching the Yajna. That is not mentioned, it's going to come later. And his name is Nachiketas, the name is mentioned here. So Nachiketas, since he was born to Vajashtavas and that too in a Vedika family, so he also had undergone Veda Adhyayanam and he have inherited a lot of wonderful samskaras. So when the father was doing the Yajna, this boy was watching. He was watching what his father distributes the Yajna. Okay, then comes the next mantra. We will chant the mantra. We will see the meaning of the mantra in the next class. The meaning of this mantra is given, Ushanghai Vajashtavasaha, simple meaning. Desiring, that what he desires is not mentioned, that will come, that we have to supply. He desires Swargaloka. Desiring Swargaloka, Vajashravas, he gave away all his wealth. And he had a son, the name Nachiketas. Tasya Nachiketa Nama Putra Asa. Okay. Then comes the next mantra. You can repeat to me. Tamha Kumaram Santam.
Tamha Kumaram Santam.
Dakshina Suniya Manasu.
Asuniya Manasu.
Shraddha Vivesha.
Shraddha Vivesha.
So Manyata.
So Manyata.
This is an mantra which has some important words. So we will discuss in detail in next class. The words Dakshina is there, Shraddha is there. So we will discuss on this mantra with the help of Acharya's Bhashyam in the next class. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.
Dhanyavadaji.
Thank you.
Dhanyavadaji.
Dhanyavadaji.